Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Our key verse for this series has been Titus 3, verse 5, which says, God saved us not because we were good enough to be saved, but because of his kindness and grace by washing away our sins, all because of what Jesus Christ our Savior did so that he could declare us good in God's eyes. Grace is based on what he's done, not what we did or what we'll indeed do. He doesn't love us less the more we do, and he doesn't love us more the less we do. He just loves us. And we can't undo what he's done by what we do or what we did. So each week we're looking at a different character, looking at different grace stories. I like that term, grace stories. We are a grace story. Last week we looked at the woman caught in adultery and the amazing grace that Jesus displayed in his amazing reaction to her, even prior to the work of the cross, knowing that what he was going to do was going to cover her sin. This week it's closer to home. One of Jesus' own disciples, who denied he knew him at the most crucial time of his life. Peter is shown God's grace, I think, in an extraordinary way. In fact, I can't think of a better example or greater example of grace and mercy than this one. So let's firstly look at Peter's life, his calling, and his failures.
Do you need help?
I'm not looking for any help.
And besides, there's nothing to help with.
Hey, what are you doing? You can't just climb into my boat.
You're right. Give me a helping hand.
What do you think you're doing?
We're going fishing.
There are no fish out there this time of day. In fact, there are no fish out here any time of day.
Peter. Just give me an hour. And I will give you a whole new life.
Who says I want one? I tell you. There's no fish out there.
How did this happen? What did you do?
I'm giving you the chance to change your life. Peter, come with me. Give up catching fish, and I will make you a fisher of men.
What are we gonna do?
Change the world.
Strong. You will all fall away.
Rabbi, I will not fall away. I will lay down my life for you.
Will you?
I will.
Peter, I tell you, before dawn, you will deny me 3 times. do what you came for.
Traitor!
Take him! Take him!
Peter!
He who lives by the sword
dies by the sword.
Take him back.
What about this one?
Get out of here.
Come on.
I won't leave him.
Peter!
Come on! Come on, Mary.
You. I've seen you before. You know him.
No. I don't know him.
You called him Rabbi.
He's nothing to do with me.
You know him. I've seen you with him.
I don't know him.
Peter, you will deny me 3 times.
Don't be afraid.
Take him to Pilate.
So we can only imagine what Peter must have felt having done something so wrong. Because I don't know whether we really appreciate how serious his denial really was. Peter denied Jesus 3 times. Once would have been bad enough. 3 times was right up there with betrayal. And we know what happened to Judas. Although I do believe if Judas had actually asked for forgiveness, he would have known the grace of God. See, Peter affirmed an oath. And the 3rd time he denied Jesus, he was effectively calling down curses and calling on God to punish him if what he said was not true. We're talking about someone who was a bold-faced and bare-faced liar. This was serious stuff. And if Peter's story had ended there, it would be tragic. But thank God, just like we are under God's grace, it goes everywhere we go. So it went where Peter went. Because Peter, too, was undercover. When we next see Peter, it appears he's pretty much given up. He feels like life as a follower of Christ was finished, and so he decided to revert to his livelihood of fishing. No doubt he felt that his sin was so serious that even though he believed in the Lord and he believed in the resurrection, he didn't feel worthy enough to serve Jesus and be used by God. Our mistakes, too, can cause us to give up and quit. We, too, feel like our life as a Christ follower has finished, and we seriously consider going back to what we used to do, our past livelihood, rather than moving forward to our future calling. We feel useless. We feel helpless. We feel hopeless. It's not what we ideally want to do, or what we want to be, but we feel it's the only option because the cost to follow the dream or fulfill the vision is too high. But we have to remember we're under cover. I'm sure that there were flashbacks in Peter's mind about the time he spent with Jesus in the parables he taught, especially the one, remember when he was eating with him and the woman anointed Jesus with perfume. You may remember the story that was a picture of love and forgiveness and mercy and grace, and how the woman expressed her gratitude for Jesus and all that she had experienced. Jesus knew Peter would need to bring to memory that particular parable, that particular picture, that particular story that he told around that time, when he too would be in need of that love and forgiveness and grace. And it was only then that Peter would fully appreciate what he was saved from, who he was saved by, and why he was saved for. We have to go through something to understand something. It's amazing what God teaches us now that we'll be reminded of next. That's why we're told to hide God's word in our heart, because we know that God's going to remind us of it at a later stage. Even this, as bad as it was covered by God's grace, because of God's love and through God's mercy. It was under the cover of God's grace. But we have a problem, Houston. Peter needs to know this. Let's look at Peter's reaction to grace with our friends, the skit guys.
Grace is God's unmerited favor for us, his crazy love. And the truth is, many times we struggle understanding it. If you find yourself struggling to understand God's grace, don't beat yourself up. Even the disciples struggled with understanding grace.
Jesus, is that you? You're alive! I can't believe you're alive! Okay, I was in the boat and I wasn't catching any fish, okay? But I heard this voice and the voice said, cast your net to the other side. And so I'm thinking, I'm a fisherman, I know what I'm doing, but I'm not catching any fish, you know? And so I throw that net over there and then a gaggle of fish pop into that net and I'm going, this is a total miracle. Who could have done that? I need to know who told me to throw the net to the other side. And boom, I look up and I mean, there is you. You're looking at me on the seashore going, it is I, the Lord, and you're alive. I can't believe you're alive. This is awesome. Andrew, get out of the boat. Come on.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
Yes, I love you. I love you. You're alive. This is so great.
Good. Then feed my sheep.
Andrew, get out of the boat. Come on, man. It's him.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
I love you. Yes. And I'm so sorry about that rooster cluck, and I had no idea what that meant, but I do not. I'm better for it, all right? Okay.
Good. Then feed my sheep.
Andrew, I'm smiling, but I'm serious. Come on, get out of the boat. It's him.
Peter.
Yeah.
Do you love me?
Jesus, mere words cannot describe the passion that I have for you. I love you. You know everything. I love you.
Good. Good. Then feed my sheep.
I didn't even know you had livestock. That is so like you, though. There's something new about you all the time. That's what I love about you.
Peter,
yeah.
Do you remember the morning the ladies went to the tomb?
Yeah. We're all in the upper room trying to figure out what to do next, you know, because we thought you were dead. You know, you were dead, you know, and we're trying to figure all that out, you know. And Mary comes running up, and Mary's like saying, beehive, beehive, beehive. And I'm thinking, I'm allergic to bees. Like, keep them out. You know what I'm saying? But as she kept getting closer, I heard her correctly. She was saying, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive. And we're going, who's alive, who's alive? And she said she was at the tomb, and the tomb was empty. And she said that there was an angel there, and the angel said, go tell the disciples and Peter that everything is okay, he is risen. And so me and John, we hightailed it down there, and if John says he beat me, he's totally lying, all right? I beat him, FYI, all right, you know? And we get down there, and I'm looking in that tomb, and it is empty. There's nothing in there, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, what does this mean? What does this mean? And John is right there. John is so good with words. He should write a book. He is so good with words. And John said, don't you get it, Peter? This is everything Jesus said he was going to do, and you did it, and it's done. Let's go. This is so great.
Wait, yeah. The angel said what?
Go tell the disciples and Peter that everything is okay. He is risen. You've risen. Let's go. This
he
is.
He said okay. What?
Go tell the disciples and Peter. Go tell the disciples and Peter. You said my name. Why did you say my name?
Peter, that's grace.
No, I don't deserve that, because that night people kept coming up to me asking me if I belonged to you, if I was with you, and I kept denying you left and right, all right? No, it'll take me my whole life to make up for what I did. It was unforgivable for what I did.
No, what I did on the cross was meant to take what is unforgivable and make it forgivable. That's my grace. It's not about you. It's always about me. That's grace, Peter.
Let me share a few things here that will help us understand Peter's restoration under grace. Firstly, Jesus didn't want Peter to go back to fishing. It wasn't that he could no longer do it, or he'd lost his touch. It was because he was no longer called to do it, and it had lost God's touch. Peter was trying to do something in his own strength, like we so often try to do, and Jesus had to show him without him, he could do nothing. Remember the conversation that he'd had with his disciples just before his crucifixion in John 15 and verse 5? Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. It's such an important lesson for you and I here to keep being who God's called us to be. Doing what he's called us to do. Where he's called us to do it, because that's where he'll bless us and cause us to be fruitful. We can't do anything without his intervention. Without him, we produce less than we need. But with him, we produce more than we want. Can you imagine how Peter felt? He was a fisherman. In fact, an expert fisherman. So not to catch anything all night was unheard of. But again, it must have just dawned on him. Maybe, you know, during that evening, a deja vu moment, being there, done that, that he suddenly thought, why am I not catching any fish? Why are we not catching any fish? It's all down to me and what I did. It's a punishment for my sin. But nothing could have been further from the truth. Because Jesus was trying to show Peter that the only consequence of his sin was merely the condemnation of his heart. In his own strength, he couldn't get back up and fulfill ministry. Because every time he would try, he would have been reminded of the denial. No, I am not one of his disciples. When we fall from grace, we have to remember grace hasn't fallen from us. I want to encourage you today that whatever you've done, whatever you did, however you've messed up, you are still the rock on which God wants to build his church. Jesus will always take us back in order to move us forward, not to punish us, but to prepare us so that when we reach that pressure point again, we won't make the same mistake. What he did on the cross takes what was unforgivable and makes it forgivable. Unlovable and makes it lovable. Unbelievable and makes it believable. Impossible and makes it possible.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.